I suppose it's been part of my racing life ever since I started riding.
But Leicester's just letting him canter. What a horse this is. He's trotted up. Nijinsky's the winner.
He'll always be remembered for his voice, which is absolutely unique, but that was backed up by probably the most tremendous knowledge of the form book.
I don't think it's original when one says he is the voice of racing, because that's what everybody regards him as.
There's a tremendous cheer from the crowd as Desert Orchid is going to win it.
Peter's voice is very unique. I think it's very seductive, actually.
This is the champion. This is the best we've seen for a long time. Arkle is the winner of the Gold Cup.
He's known as the voice of racing, and I think that really just sums him up.
Well, there'll never be another, will there?
Ingrained in the memory, the low bass voice reverberating like the pounding of hooves through our senses.
And it's supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
It's been a lifetime with horses for Peter, from his grey pony Cinders through to the racehorses that he owned and bred, like the grey mare Friendly Again. And Friendly's been the key word in his racing life, as his first television employer, Peter Dimmock, recalls.
I think that he had this wonderful, wonderful ability to be friends with everyone, and more importantly, to be trusted by everyone. I mean, he was a great friend of Lester Piggott's, great friend Bert in his local garage, but at the same time, great friends with all the important people in the Jockey Club.
He also had dozens of friends in Chantilly, the headquarters of French racing and the source of some notable newspaper scoops and anti-post bets on the major races.
Peter was known by the whole of the professional crowd and the major owners, obviously. You know, he was a very good friend of the Marchesa, he is a very good friend of Marchesa de Maratella and Alec Head and so on. I mean, he's obviously in front known as the English personage.
Peter's been a wonderful man to racing, a perfectionist, and a very fair man. I wouldn't say that all the journalists are that fair. I'm sorry to have to say that to you, but it's true.
And his commentaries?
His commentaries are unique. His voice is unique. He's very lucky to have such a wonderful voice.
It's Seabird on the wing. Seabird now being chased by Reliance. Seabird from Reliance. Carver is not far behind him. Then Dieterme and Annalyn. Seabird from Reliance in second place. Then comes Dieterme, then Annalyn. And Seabird swerving as he races up to the line. But he's being patted by Kratjan, a great champion. Seabird's the winner.
Pantsalev is the leader from Pilsudski and Swain as they race up towards the line. A big finish by Oskar Schindler. But Pantsalev is going to win the Arc de Triomphe as they race up towards the line. Pantsalev has won it. Pilsudski in second.
It was at Longchamp that Peter was honoured by Louis Romanet of France Galop, the French jockey club.
Peter in England is known as the voice of racing. You can listen to his commentary, close your eyes, and you know exactly where is every horse in the race. He is the most famous commentator of the century. That's why we wanted to pay a tribute to him.
The bronze was a warm appreciation of Peter's role as ambassador for French racing. There's been no one in the press or television who's had a closer relationship with Lester Piggott.
St. Paddy now from Kithnos and Alcaeus. Orion fourth place, 20 yards to run, and it's St. Paddy now from Alcaeus and Kithnos. And at the line, St. Paddy's the winner, Alcaeus the second, Kithnos third.
Nijinsky striding away from him. Nijinsky going away, being chased by Blakeney now. It's the two Derby winners who look like being first and second. Lester Piggott looks over his shoulder. Blakeney's making ground on him, but Lester's just letting him canter. What a horse this is. He's trotted up. Nijinsky's the winner. Blakeney's second. And it's Hopgrove from the Minstrel, Gloshingrub and Monseigneur. 100 yards to run in the Derby. The Minstrel coming to challenge Hopgrove. And it's Lester Piggott and William Carson. The Minstrel on the near side, Hopgrove on the north side. And the Minstrel wins it from Hopgrove. Gloshingrub is third.
Despite his personal highs and lows described by Peter, it was typical of Lester to eulogise elsewhere.
Well, I always thought, you know, he was at his best in the Grand National, because that seemed to be the hardest race to know all the colours, and there's so many runners, and he was marvellous year after year, you know, how he used to go through the whole field and never make a mistake.
It was 1960 that saw the first televised Grand National after a long contractual battle with Mirabelle Topham.
25 yards to run for Merriman as he runs up towards the line with 22-year-old Jerry Scott aboard. Merriman looks certain to win. He's got 10 yards to run to the line, and at the line, Merriman is the winner of the National.
54-year-old John Thorne putting in a storming finish. It's Aldeniti from Spartan Missile. Aldeniti is going to win it. At the line, Aldeniti wins the National. Spartan Missile is second.
Mini Homer and Just So as they race towards the line. Mini Homer is going to win the National from Just So. Mini Homer has won it. Just So is second, and third is Moorcroft Boy.
The 12-year-old Red Rum being preceded only by Loose Horses, being chased by Churchtown Boy. Eye Catcher has moved into third with the Bill Garlick fourth. They're coming to the elbow. There's a furlong now between Red Rum and his third Grand National triumph, and he's coming up to the line to win it like a fresh horse in great style. His hat's off and a tremendous reception. You've never heard one like it at Liverpool. Red Rum wins the National.
Magical days, actually. Probably the 77th could possibly have been the best and most expressive, perhaps, you know what I mean? But Peter, you know, what can you say about him? Always a super gentleman, always a super race reader, and the most knowledgeable man in the business.
Watching it on the tape now is a great feeling, because he really sent it home to the people sitting at home watching on television. He got everybody on the edge of their seats, and he could keep the whole audience together at any time.
I think my most memorable commentary from Peter was at Cheltenham, the year Garrison Savannah won the Gold Cup. And I must say that he caused me to die standing up that day, because he is very friendly with the owners of the fellow. And during the commentary, Peter saying, and the fellow's getting up, and the fellow's getting up. And literally, I was wedged in the stands that tight that if I hadn't have been, I'd have been in a heap on the floor.
Garrison Savannah has a three-length advantage, but the fellow's cutting him down as they race towards the line. The fellow's putting in a tremendous run. The fellow is sprinting. The fellow is going to get up. He's going to get up. The fellow and Garrison Savannah in the photo. Garrison Savannah's just won it.
There is no race that is complete without him calling it home. I think it's one of the things about Channel 4 doing Cheltenham. You know, you miss Peter O'Sullivan calling home the Gold Cup winners and the Champion Hurdle winners and the Queen Mother winners.
Arkell coming to the last now, and Arkell a length clear of Milhouse. He's over and clear. Milhouse is trying to challenge him again, but it's Arkell on the stand side. Milhouse over on the far side, coming up towards the line, and Arkell is holding him. Arkell going away now from Milhouse. This is the champion. This is the best we've seen for a long time. Arkell is the winner of the Gold Cup.
Sea Pigeon jumps it in the lead from Monksfield on the near side. It's Monksfield on the near side. Sea Pigeon on the far side. There's nothing between them as they race up the hill. It's Monksfield on the near side, Sea Pigeon on the far side. Monksfield is just surging ahead. He's going to win it. Forgive and Forget on the near side now as they come to the final fence. Forgive and Forget is going to jump marginally in the lead from Wayward Lad. Forgive and Forget on the near side, Wayward Lad on the far side. It's Wayward Lad, the veteran, trying to break his Cheltenham hoodoo, being pressed on by Dawn Run in the centre. Forgive and Forget on the near side as they race to the line. And the mare's beginning to get up, and as they come to the line, she's made it. Dawn Run has won it. It's Desert Orchid on the near side, Yahoo on the far side. Desert Orchid drifting over towards the stand side. He's beginning to get up. Desert Orchid is beginning to get up as they race to...
We had a great party, and I remember playing it through that night with the staff, and I can almost remember it. He says, and Desi's going to do it, Desi's going to get up, and Desert Orchid has won the Gold Cup.
There's a tremendous cheer from the crowd as Desert Orchid is going to win it. Desert Orchid has won the Gold Cup. Yahoo is second.
He's very unflappable, isn't he? Very, very good. Terrific at calling all the races. Of course, there's the TiVo, where he didn't get excited at all.
A TiVo was the little horse that Peter owned and bred that was hot favourite for the Triumph Hurdle at the Cheltenham Festival.
And the crowd shouting for him here at Cheltenham now as Ativo comes to the final flight, about three lengths clear of Gleaming Silver and Bonlieu. This is the last flight now. Ativo over, he hits it hard, but he hasn't stopped his impetus. And Ativo now being pressed by Bonlieu on the far side. And Bonlieu getting up. It's Ativo on the near side, Bonlieu on the far side. 150 yards to run. Ativo from Bonlieu. Bonlieu and Ron Berry making ground on the far side, but Ativo's going to hold him. And at the line, Ativo's the winner. Second is Bonlieu. And so the result of the 1974 Daily Express Triumph Hurdle is first number three, Ativo, owned by Peter O'Sullivan.
The one instruction that Robert had, who rode him, Robert Hughes, was at no stage take your finger out of the neck strap. That is absolutely lethal because he will just take off with you. And he'd kept it in until the last, and he let go because he was about 8 lengths clear going to the last, and I think emotion overcame him, and he let go, and that was the worst thing to do. How he stayed on, I don't know. He went 6 feet high, the horse went the wrong way, but they came down together over the last, and a big sigh of relief, and he just galloped on to victory. And I've walked into some Cheltenham unsaddling enclosures in the past few years, but I was in tears that day, and I've never, ever felt that emotion ever since. I mean, it was just electric.
On the course and in Tattersall's ring, there's no face who's earned greater respect. First as a newspaper tipster, but more important, as a significant punter. For many years, the key question was, what's O'Sullivan backed? His early morning telephone calls to obliging bookmakers are legendary, and the market would always react.
If he suddenly tipped something which you didn't, wasn't a sort of obvious tip, you pricked up your ears and took serious notice.
I'm going back now when jockeys aren't supposed to bet. And I can go back many, many years ago, and there was a horse at Sandown Park. I think he was called the Major. And I went running out, and I thought he'd win, and I wanted to have 20 quid on him, you know. And I saw Peter there standing, and I said, Peter, yes, he said, what do you want? I said, can you get me 20 quid on this? I said, I think he'll win. He said, of course I can. And we all trusted Peter. This is the thing, you all had utter confidence in him that if he asked you anything off on the side, it wasn't going to be in the papers the following day. You know, you could confide in him, which was a great thing, I think.
Well, I mean, he's been a friend to us all for a long time, and he's part of racing, and you know, we'll miss him very much, the voice anyway, but we won't miss the person because he'll be around. He's a member of the Jockey Club, and I hope that they use him in some way or another because I think he'd be a tremendous asset to racing.
In 1967, during an outbreak of foot and mouth disease, racing was banned. So Grandstand decided to cover two major races with the help of a computer.
The machine here ticking, and they'll shortly be underway. They're off, and any moment now I'll be receiving the order as they come to the first fence.
I mean, it's unique because you can shut your eyes, put a commentary of a race, and you could picture every horse in their exact position. And I think there was the perfect description of Sir Peter O'Sullivan's talent and unique voice, so he'd be greatly missed.
With Peter O'Sullivan, it was the rhythm. Always the rhythm.
That smoky, breathy voice, building tension through the race, running through the names and its charm school, from How's Your Father with Appledore and Sandboy tucked in behind, and Surfeit bringing up the rear as they come to the third.
The briefest of pauses, a heartbeat, then upper semitone.
Safely over the third, they're neck and neck now, as they come towards the turn.
The best racehorse that he ever owned was the champion sprinter, Be Friendly.
Be Friendly was, of course, a total joy to me. He was it was the first horse on which I'd ever spent any money, which I'd laid out quite a few quid. And therefore, it was doubly satisfying that he should turn out to be good.
And it's Be Friendly going away from Green Park, and Don Dean is the race up towards the line. Be Friendly is clear from Green Park in second place. Don Dean is third. That's the result. Be Friendly the winner. Green Park second. Don Dean is third. First, number 13, Be Friendly, owned by Peter O'Sullivan.
Peter's always enjoyed royal approval. It's no secret that the Queen favours the O'Sullivan commentary. While the Princess Royal, having watched the master at work, bestowed a rare honour by unveiling a specially commissioned bronze on the day of his 50th and final Grand National, even if the race itself took place 2 days late.
A fantastic performance of jumping this by Lord Galeen, getting a tremendous reception from the crowd. A terrific performance this. Lord Galeen carries the colours of Stanley Clark to victory. Lord Galeen is the winner of the 1997 National.
It's been an autumn of salutation, not just for Peter's eminence, but also in recognition of his long-standing efforts on behalf of both racing and horse charities, notably the International League for the Protection of Horses.
When you reach my time of life, three things happen. First, you begin to lose your memory. Then, I can't remember the other two.
Now it's a day of memories and visions of races and winners long gone by. After 50 years comes the final aria from a voice that's excited racegoers and every racing enthusiast for three generations.
Well, 50 minutes.